Cruelty to animals is illegal, but sometimes these policies aren't enforced or there is no policy in place at all. Animals can't speak for themselves, and that is what the Animal Wellness Action does. They speak for animals in several ways to keep them safe in the wild, in the home, and in industry. Joining me this morning to talk about how they do this and how you can get involved is their executive director, Marty Irby. Good morning, Marty. Welcome to Maryland Perspectives.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me on today.
Now, let's talk about the different ways that you advocate for animals. First, you champion for more laws. What laws are you supporting today to stop animal cruelty?
We do. That's our primary focus, and especially on the federal level. And the most important of those that we're working on is the Prevent All Soaring Tactics Act, which would end the abusive practice of soaring, S-O-R-I-N-G, Tennessee walking, racking, and spotted saddle horses, and that's where they intentionally inflict pain to horses' front feet to make them lift their legs high to win prizes.
Ooh.
And the legislation that we've been working on is an amendment to the Horse Protection Act of 1970 that was actually authored and passed by your former Maryland U.S. Senator Joe Tidings, who was a very good friend of mine that passed away last fall. And we just recently, in July, passed by a vote of 333-96, the Prevent All Soaring Tactics Act, and it had been named this time, this Congress, in honor of Senator Tidings through the House, thanks to the help of Majority Leader Steny Hoyer and his team and the Tidings family in Maryland.
Right, because we have a huge horse industry there, and I've never heard of that. That sounds like show horses where they kind of prance around the stadium. So you're saying that there's pain inflicted in order for that animal to perform that trick?
That's right, yes. It's
wow.
Very common and has been going on since the 1950s and early 60s. I've tried for most of my adult life to stop it, but it continues on, and it's a rogue group of people, primarily in Tennessee and Kentucky, but throughout the Southeast, that continue this practice.
Now, for laws that are already in place, how do you help make sure that they are enforced to keep animals safe?
Well, several ways. The Horse Protection Act is a good example. We lobby both the administration and the USDA to make sure that that law is enforced. Unfortunately, under Secretary Tony Perdue and the Trump administration, it's been pretty terrible, honestly. They're not enforcing the Horse Protection Act, and they are letting abusers get by with just a pass of very few penalties. Several of the pro-soaring trainers in Tennessee recently had agreed to consent decisions with USDA where they don't take suspension some until 2022 and will continue showing horses for violations and don't even start a suspension until then. But prior to the past few years, we've been very successful at helping push to enforce the Horse Protection Act. And another way that we're working to enforce laws is to ramp up our efforts through the Department of Justice. The Department of Justice actually has the authority to enforce the Horse Protection Act, to enforce the crush video law and animal fighting laws. And they haven't done so. I think they've only had two cases they've prosecuted in the past 6 years. So this year in the appropriations that we've been working for, funding for the federal government, we were able to get a $2 million provision in the House package that would give $2 million just to the U.S. Department of Justice, primarily for focusing on enforcing those particular laws. Creating an animal crimes unit, if you will, at the Department of Justice.
Wow.
That's very encouraging, and that's been a big focus for us this year.
Yeah, I don't see how you can't support, you know, animals. It's sort of a no-brainer. Like, oh, they're being abused. Let's stop that. It's easy. All right, let's pass this. Let's do that. But it takes foundations like yours, the Animal Wellness Action, to really kind of get in people's faces and let them know this is happening, as well as exposing animal abusers. Now, we get stories here in Baltimore all the time about dogs being abused. A lot of it's, initiations into gangs or mental illness or what have you. Now, give us a recent example of how you're exposing animal abusers.
There are several different ways. In Kansas, we work with an organization, the Organization for Competitive Markets, and this is sort of an indirect expose. There's a system called the checkoff programs within USDA that are sort of quasi-governmental agencies that have been illegally and inappropriately using farmers' tax dollars for lobbying purposes. That's trickled down into the state, that's tied back to the National Cattlemen's Beef Association here in Washington, D.C. What they're doing is basically illegally using federal dollars for lobbying purposes that they're not supposed to be doing. So it's sort of a one-off, but
that's a good one.
On issues like that. Yeah, it's a little complicated. Most people haven't ever heard of a checkoff, but we also are working on several other undercover issues. We have some news I can't just tell you a lot about yet, but we will see more on the soaring issue coming to light. Last year, we received some information about a case of soaring in Alabama, and earlier this year released video footage of a horse that had been soared and was in terrible, terrible pain in the racking horse industry. So, you know, it's across the board, whether it be through government corruption that negatively impacts animals or direct abuse, we try to work and expose those that are engaging in inappropriate behavior.
So who do you partner with in Maryland in order to talk to state legislators or to work keeping animals safe here in this state?
Well, we don't have a lot of groups in Maryland because we haven't gotten our feet on the ground on the state level yet. We're hoping to do that. I will say, though, that we have worked on the horse racing issue with doping on the federal level with the Stronach Group, who actually owns Pimlico Racetrack. They're part of a coalition that we're all working to pass federal legislation to end drugging. I'm sure you've seen that in the headlines.
Sure.
And many people, of course, are very familiar with the Preakness. I mean, I know that's one of the big major features in Baltimore. So we work with them. As I said, we've worked with U.S. House Majority Leader Steny Hoyer and his team and worked with all of the federal legislators in Congress on these issues. I say Maryland has a really great delegation overall, with the exception of Andy Harris. He's a little bit difficult to deal with sometimes.
Yeah, they all are.
A lot of people feel that way.
No, I'm familiar with Andy. Yeah, he has his moments, doesn't he? But, you know, it's funny. We were talking off the air a little bit. We're at such a divisive time in our country that things like this, I think, are easy to rally around. You know, let's keep horses safe. Let's make sure that our food industry is being humane to the animals that, you know, obviously we're eating. There's a lot of money involved here. There's a lot of profit-based abuse happening, which kind of leads me to my next question, because I am always shocked by animal cruelty, whether it's done by an individual, a group of people, or even by corporations. Is there any science behind why the abuse of animals is happening? And does it register as abuse to these corporations, individuals, groups?
Well, I think there are two ways to look at this. Yes, I do believe there is a lot of science behind this as far as cruelty within the animal protection world. There have been numerous studies that have been done and by psychologists who have found that people who commit the most egregious acts of animal torture and cruelty actually go on to abuse humans, become serial killers. And so law enforcement that we work with wants to try to catch those people upstream, if you will, before they engage in activities that would harm humans. So it's a very good indication that if they're harming animals, I've seen instances where someone burned a dog alive in a barrel, just terrible, terrible cases, and want to catch those people early on before things get worse with them as time progresses. Now, if you look at that from, you know, just a cruelty aspect, that's a little bit different than what we see in industrial agriculture and farming, where you have pigs that are raised in gestation crates and aren't ever allowed to turn around, aren't really able to move their entire life. You have chickens that are raised in cages, sometimes six or seven in a cage the size of a microwave. That's terrible cruelty that's very systemic and that our society, for the most part, I believe, is really unaware of and not even aware of what they're eating and the type of food that they're, you know, ingesting that come from those type of practices. There is a shift, and that has changed. We see, I'm sure many people out there have heard of, you know, cage-free eggs. That's probably the most commonly talked about issue, where those chickens aren't necessarily housed in cages, and they may or may not have, depending on the type of cage-free or free-range eggs, space to move around. But those are the types of things that we're really working to try to change across the board, because it impacts so many billions of animal lives. You know, one at a time, try to stop people who are committing acts of cruelty, and we want to do that, but we also want to help our society shift into a more humane nation as well.
Sure, and it's all about enforcement. So, you know, we need an enforcement agency that has enough feet on the ground to go out there and look for it, be able to write the tickets, be able to bring that to light. Because as it stands, it really comes down to some guy with his iPhone that's going to sneak onto a property. And next thing you know, we're getting these documentaries on Netflix like Food Inc. and different things like that. And then you're looking at it going, how come I don't know this is happening? So is that really kind of the thrust with Animal Wellness Action, is that you're bringing a lot of this stuff to light besides working with governmental agencies?
Yes, absolutely. Two things. We formed recently a National Law Enforcement Council that's headed up by Drew Edmondson, the former attorney general in Oklahoma. And he's working to bring people on board that will help participate in trying to expose these egregious acts of cruelty and enforce the current law. And I actually, just before you, was on a call with the gentleman, Dr. Jim Keene from Nebraska, who was the whistleblower at the Meat Animal Research Center, which is a USDA facility out in Nebraska that had engaged and is still currently engaging in just egregious acts of torture, experimenting on animals, funded by the taxpayer. He was on the cover of the New York Times when this happened a couple of years ago, and so he's now on our veterinary advisory council that we just had our first call on about an hour ago.
So how can 98 Rock listeners get involved? How can they get more information from you about what you do and then maybe even help you be the boots on the ground that we're talking about?
We welcome everyone and encourage everyone to please visit our website, www.animalwellnessaction.org, and you'll find a lot of information about our campaigns, the various states and federal issues that we're working on. And most importantly, really the most easy thing you can do is either take one of our action alerts, just requires a few clicks of a button from your laptop to send a message in to your members of Congress, and to call 202-224-3121, which is the Capitol switchboard, to tell your members of Congress about how you feel about these issues and that you want to see legislation to help animals pass.
Marty Irby is the executive director of Animal Wellness Action. I'll make sure I get that link and that phone number up on our website, 98online.com. Thank you so much, Marty, for telling us how you fight for animals all over the country and for getting people involved. I hope we get a few more today.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Amelia. I greatly appreciate you having me, and glad to talk anytime.